50 slides to fill 1 hour. But I hope, especially the students, you can ask me enough questions. My students, compulsory. Okay, so. So first I'll talk about the problem of segmentation and that of multi-atlas segmentation. So by segmentation, I basically mean this. We have a picture in which there is some object of interest, and we want to do one of these two things. We want to delineate the boundary of the object automatically, or equivalently, say for solid objects, we want to label each pixel in the image as whether, you know, to indicate whether it belongs to the object or not. Okay, yeah. So this label image, as we call it, is a segmentation of the intensity image that we have as an input. All right. Now, the framework of segmentation by example is basically this. We want to do perform an image segmentation task on a certain class of images, and what we are given is a large database of pre-segmented images. So these are pre-segmented by manual experts in that domain, and the object of interest is weakly visible in the image. Okay, so of course, if there is clear contrast between the intensities in the interior of the object and the exterior of the object, then the data basically gives you all the information to perform the segmentation task or the delineation task. Right, so those would be simple problems of image segmentation. We have a problem where either because of biological reasons or because of imaging constraints, constraints put on by the imaging device or the application, we have images where there is not enough contrast between the intensities in the interior of the object and those outside. Or there could be, or the images could have a high level of noise that again make it difficult to differentiate between the interior of the object and the outside. And so we want to, so for such difficult image segmentation problems, we want to exploit this vast knowledge of information that is there in the database put in by human experts to perform our task. So just to set up some notation or jargon, we are going to call a template. We are going to call an acquired medical image as a template. We are going to call an image of labels for pixels, or 3D equivalent being voxels, an image of labels for the image or the image of probabilities. So labels could be interpreted, or probabilities could also be interpreted as a generalized notion of labels. So instead of labeling each pixel at whether it belongs to the interior of the object or not, we could assign each pixel a probability of it being in the interior of the object or not. Okay, so we could have a softer or a fuzzier segmentation of the object. Right, so we have the notion of a template, we have a notion of a segmentation, and the notion of an atlas is a pair of a template image and its corresponding manually segmented image. Right. So the framework of multi-atlas segmentation gives us an entire sequence of atlases, hence the name multi-atlas. So here is, for instance, an example of a a structure that we want to segment. So the red boundary is, say, the true boundary, which is unknown, and we want to infer the red boundary somehow from the information in this database. Now, as you see in this structure, this is some structure in the human brain as it appears in a specific kind of MRI. So the contrast between the colors in the inside of the structure and the outside is quite clear in these regions, but as we go close to this end of the structure, the contrast between where the structure stops and a new structure begins is not clear. Now, of course, you may ask, how did an expert come, infer this boundary? And the answer is that the expert has other sources of information, not necessarily MRI, maybe histology or something else. They know exactly, they have a much better, much more information about, say, the shape of where the object lies, or where the structure lies as relative to the locations of other structures that can be well identified in the image, and so on and so forth. So all this training background information that is there in the head of the expert goes into giving us this segmentation. Okay, although this particular data is not very indicative of the segmentation in this part of the object. Okay. All right, so here is another pictorial description of the problem. So this is these are CT images of the spleen, and the idea is so we have, so this is our multi-atlas database. We have images of spleens, and we have expert segmentations, which are these binary images, whether the pixel is inside the object or not. Now we have this target image where there appears a spleen, and the goal is to assign a label to each pixel in this image, indicating which pixel belongs to the spleen or not. Okay, is that clear? All right. Okay, so these kind of algorithms have been explored over the last 5-6 years or so. Most popular algorithms handle this problem in the following way. So this is the recipe underlying most popular algorithms out there. So given a target image, we first find those templates, a few templates in our Atlas database that appear most similar to the target. Then, knowing that, we deform or warp the template images so that they match best the target image, right? So for instance, the shapes of the spleens here and their sizes are quite different from the shape and size of the spleen in the target image. This is just because of natural variability. So imagine that we apply a warp on the image domain here, the 2D space, such that this image gets warped to best match the target image here. Right, so we compute such warps between template images in the database and the target image. Then we take those warps and apply the same warps, same spatial transformation, to the segmentation image that we have in our Atlas database. All right. Now, applying these k warps to k such segmentations, one warp each to one segmentation, we have essentially k answers. We have k label images. We have k spleen segmentations for the target image, and then the last step is basically somehow try to combine or fuse the information, some kind of weighted averaging or whatever you want to use. It's typically referred to as label fusion. So you want to combine this information into our k segmented images into one segmented image. Okay, so here is the corresponding illustration. We have Atlas database, target image. This map here, this fuzzy map, is essentially obtained by warping each of those template images to the target image, applying the same warps on these binary images 0, 1 to this, to the coordinate space of this image, and we are just overlaying the intensities, overlaying the labels obtained from each of those k warps, right? So we have this image, and using this information, the label fusion step gets us somehow a binary segmentation of the target image, or a segmentation, not necessarily binary.
I have a question. Yeah. Could you describe this warping process?
Right. Yeah. So okay. So the easiest kind of warps would essentially do a rigid body transformation, all right, applied on the coordinate frame. Okay, more general warps would do affine transformations, and even more general warps would do nonlinear transformations, but under the restriction that these warps are diffeomorphic. Okay, so there is a one-to-one mapping between the spatial coordinates in the template image and the target image, and this is smooth, and of course invertible, right? So the method is right. So there is smoothness, right? So yeah. So there is a well. Okay. The shapes of okay. So there is no prior. Right now the framework that I'm talking about does not impose any prior information on the shapes of these objects. But in most cases, it is assumed that these are compact. The transformation is always smooth, all right. So if these labels are varying smoothly over space, then after the transformation is applied, the labels continue to vary smoothly over space.
I'm just wondering whether by assuming those priors, you can.
Yes, you can do better, of course. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Sure. Yes. Yeah.
So is there an objective function, loss function that is warping is trying to minimize?
Oh yeah. Absolutely. right. So that is the topic of interest in the subfield of image registration or image warping. So yes. So for instance, if you are warping two images of say exactly the same modality, this is CT scanner image scanned using the same parameter sequence, another CT image scanned using the same parameter sequence, then you may want to design a warp that minimizes the mean squared error, for instance. That's the most, integrated over the entire spatial domain. Okay, right, now if these images are of different modalities, right, so this is an MRI, that's a CT, the appearance is completely different, the mean squared error may not work out very well, because you know, dark colors here may correspond to light colors there and so on. So you can use more general measures of similarity, say using some information theory criteria like mutual information or others. Okay?
Well, in general, like, these might be different people's planes, right?
Correct, they are.
So maybe different planes are like very different.
Yeah. Right. So the hope is that you have a large enough size database such that any random guy comes in like me, there are some people in the database whose spleen sizes and shape match mine. So the matching works out well. Yes.
So, is this problem used to identify outliers or common cases? Or,
no.
For example, is this used to flag?
Yeah. I'll tell you.
Bad or?
No. Even if things are normal. Well, okay. You go to a hospital when there is always a suspicion of something not normal. Fine. So let's say there is some risk of some person having a spleen disorder, and say you want to find either the size of the spleen in this guy or the shape of the spleen in that guy. All right, so for to get such measures, you have to first segment the spleen out. Okay, now the segmentation of the spleen here is, you don't want to do it manually. It does because it's too, it's too difficult. Now the spleen is actually a 3D structure. We are 3D, so manual segmentation is difficult. Okay, good point. So the thing is, there is okay where in part okay. So in this part of the image, in this part of the spleen, for instance, okay, there is a very clear contrast between intensities inside and outside. So if I ask what should be the segmentation here, almost all of you are going to say that this part should be inside the spleen, that part should be outside the spleen. But what about this region? Things are not very clear. All right. So we may make some assumptions, right? Some of us may have more knowledge of the spleen than others, and so some may come up with better estimates than others. Even doctors, right? If you ask 5 doctors to segment the spleen using just this image and information, they'll come up with 5 different boundaries in this part of the spleen. So the question is, what is the ground truth? I mean, there is no real ground truth unless you really slice open the person and look at the spleen. But you want to do that.
So, but then what? Which gets back to the question, what is the objective of this exercise?
The objective, okay. So, given that manual segmentation is tough, plus automated segmentation is also not going to be super easy, right? As you suggested, to get a good segmentation of the spleen, especially in this part, you should be exploiting information on about shape, a spleen shape and size. All right. So that information is implicitly encoded into this database. All right. So we want to get all this, all that information in this database, and map that information to the target image space and come up with a good decision. Yeah. No, it's just to process a large database. Yeah, so that, right, so you are going to use this information. You will use the information of the size and the shape of the spleen to later detect, to give some information to the physician whether this guy size and shape, spleen size and shape is tending to abnormal or not. Annotations, you mean? Okay, maybe for this particular application. All right. So I'll tell you another application where there may not be any annotations. All right. So let's say you just want to, right? Let's say there is a new disorder. Okay, some new spleen disease that nobody knows how it's going to affect. Or let's say, let's say, forget disease. Let's say we just don't know for some structure of interest for some structure of interest, we just don't know the normal variability of some say the size and the shape of the structure in the population. Okay, we just want to study that. Okay, let's say nobody did a quantitative study before. We want to study that. So to study that, we have to segment that structure. All right, how are you going to segment that structure? Manually is too difficult because 3D, large population. Okay, so you make, right, so you do a few, you want to ask the experts to do a few segmentations, say on 50 images, and then use those to segment a large database of maybe 2,000 images. Now you have segmentations on 2,000 images, all right? Now you do your subsequent quantitative analysis, say you measure size or you measure shape variability, and now you know how the size and the shape of this particular structure varies across the population, which nobody ever did before. Now you have a baseline of the variability for normal individuals. Okay, now imagine that there are individuals who are deceased, all right? And now, right, so now they will have, so they may have spleens of different sizes or different shapes. All right, now, but now given that you have a statistical model on the normal variability, you could use this model, for instance, to give a probability of this new guy being an outlier or not. Or, for instance, let's say you want to understand whether how a particular variant of, say, a new disease is going to affect the shape of the spleen. Okay? Does it constrict this way or does it constrict that way or what? I mean, whatever, okay? So in that case, then you would want to do, you would want to process a large database of normal people, spleens, and a large database of deceased people who have that disorder, and now you have one statistical distribution on the control cases. You have one distribution on the disease cases, and then you want to do some kind of a hypothesis test and determine whether there is a, first of all, whether there is a significant difference, and then if so, of what kind, and so on and so forth. Okay, so underlying these later level applications is the basic task of segmentation. All right? Yes? How will you choose the weights? I'm coming there. Okay. Shall I? Okay, so this is what popular algorithms do. Okay. Now, what the problem is that, of course, there can be errors in segmentation. There is definitely inter-expert variability. Registration methods, right? Depending on what method you use, what algorithm to solve the optimization, what's the objective function, you know, what's the similarity measure, so on and so forth. You will get different answers. So, so there is some variation here as well, and there may be, right? There may be variation in nature itself, relative. So, for instance, before I go there, okay. So why are we exploiting image registration methods? So, we are exploiting image registration methods for the following. Although there are parts of the structure that are not easily, where the boundary of the structure is not easily identifiable, there are structures around this part that are clearly identifiable. These structures, in clearly identifiable, not only this image but all images in the database. Okay, so when we are trying to match template images in the database to the target image, the registration is going to be driven by features that are clearly seen in the image and which have corresponding features in every other image. So the features that are clearly visible are going to get mapped well, and labels for that part of the image where features are not clearly visible are going to be interpolated implicitly using the spatial regularity constraints that we pose on the deformation. Right? So the deformation maps this corner in this image to a similar corner in the other image. The deformation maps this corner in this image to a similar corner in another image. And it says that, well, okay, if these two corners in the other image map to those two corners there, then some point in the middle has to map to some point in the middle here. Yeah. Yeah.
Then, I mean, your retrieval is basically going to be dominated by features which are not in that tiny area of interest. So, let's say my.
Yeah.
Exactly,
yes.
That part is different.
So, yeah. So, right. So, the most trivial way of doing k nearest neighbors would be, or an expensive but probably a good way of doing k nearest neighbors will be to do all registrations of targets in the image, targets in a database to this, sorry, all registrations of all templates in the database to the target here, and only after the registration you can pick. And so, right, but of course this would be slow if you have a very large database and you know you are pressed for time, so then you can do some engineering tricks to make this process faster. Okay, but at an abstract level, okay, right now I'm just talking about an abstract level. I haven't dived into the main problem yet. I am still covering the background. Okay, so the problem is, alright, so the problem is, even though, right, nature has these two features corresponding in every image, the location of, say, this point on the boundary relative to these two features may have a natural stochastic variation across individuals. Alright, so there are different types of variability that we may come across, and right. So the problem is how to deal with that variability, how to model such variability, and and how to answer the questions that we want to answer. Okay, so a few questions that we want to answer is, first of all, how to choose the number of atlases k based on the size of the database, all right? So it would make sense, for instance, right? So we would want templates that are nearest to us. It would probably do harm to take templates that are very far away from us, because maybe the registration did not work perfectly. You know, the mapping between the labels is just not good enough as given by registration, and so on and so forth. So how do you choose k? Now once you have k, the number k, which k atlases to use, and there were many works that talked about this. Then given that you have these k atlases that you have chosen, how do you perform the label fusion? And then the most important question, because we tried to solve it, is, how large a database would it take to keep the segmentation error below a specified tolerance level? All right, right. So imagine again, if you want the application scenario, it is this. Right, we don't want expert segmentations on a very large database of 10,000 images. That might be an overkill. Expert segmentations are expensive and laborious. We might, as I said before, only want the experts first to do segmentations on, say, 40 images, and then evaluate how the segmentation error decreases as the number of atlases in the database increase. All right. So we want a model for the segmentation error as the number of with increasing number of atlases in the database, and we want to extrapolate this model, this curve, to that level where the error is below our specified tolerance, and then we can use this curve to look up how many atlases would we need. So we want to answer that, we want to make that prediction. That is the problem. Yeah. So given the quality of the atlas, whatever quality, right? You give me an atlas of this quality, of this class, for this class of images, for for this particular anatomical structure, for this particular imaging modality, you're using this registration method and a particular level fusion method, right? Under this scenario, okay, so this is a specific scenario. So if somebody has to deploy this method in a hospital, for instance, right, they will be working with a very specific scenario. So for that specific scenario, I want to predict how many atlases do I need. All right? Of course, K varies. I'm going to talk about how to choose K. K varies as a function of database size. But what is a good image? We don't know what a good image is. So K will depend on the class of images. So instead of like one specific image, K would depend on the class of images that we want to segment, or we want to apply this to. And let's assume all images in that class are equally good or bad. Yeah. Correct. Yeah, but we are not optimizing. Right now we are not tackling the problem of optimizing K for a specific image. We are only tackling the problem of optimizing K for a class of images. So on an average, they will do good. That K will do good.
So do you want to pick K given the number of instances in your database, or given the database itself? Can you run through your images and then say, I need 40 labels? Or are you saying you want to come up with the number 40 just by saying I have 10,000 images?
Sorry, repeat that, please.
Are you trying to pick K?
Yes.
Number of atlases.
Yes.
Merely based on the number of images in your database, or based on the database itself? Can you look through the images in the database?
Oh, of course. Oh, yeah, of course. Okay. Yes, both.
Okay.
Both.
So it's like active learning, right? In some sense.
I don't know what active learning exactly means.
For later.
Okay. Yeah.
If your target, I mean, are you assuming that your image is drawn from anywhere in that database? And then, so if I get a target image which is from that deceased screen,
correct.
Then I presumably want
similar images, yes.
But I mean, the number of images that I'm willing to take might be different for that image as opposed to.
Yeah.
So this is some kind of a very, very global average.
Very global average, yes. Okay. Indeed, very global average. Right, so the simplest scenario is, yeah, just assume everybody is in the same class. I mean, let's say there's no disease class, everybody is normal. The problem is difficult enough just because of normal variability. Yeah. Right, so I'll go into the mathematics of it and it will be more clear, but intuitively, as your, so let's say your database consists of images of everybody in this world, okay, there's just more, it makes it, so instead of 100 people in this city, you have images of everybody in the world, there's probably going to be, there will be a larger probability of finding templates that are more closer to the target in a larger database. Okay, so given templates, if we find an exact template, I mean, that's great. So the more templates we find that are closer to the target, the better we are going to do. Yes.
Fixed K
arbitrary database size. Yeah. I'll talk about how to optimize K as well. Okay. So because we are allowed to re-represent each image in different coordinate frames based on a diffeomorphic transformation on the spatial domain, so we assume each target represents the entire family of such images. we constrain the we assume that the diffeomorphism is constrained so that very weird, right? So even though smooth extreme warps aren't allowed. So let us assume, right? So let us, okay. So now I'm starting going. I'm starting to go into notation. So let's assume f as a random vector that corresponds to the intensities in the deformed template. S is a random vector that corresponds to intensities in the deformed segmentation image. We are given a database of size capital M, which has these pairs fm, sm of templates and segmentations. The target image is F0, and we want to find, right, we want to estimate the segmentation S0 associated with F0. Okay, so the first thing that we do is, right, we have to choose a regression function. So we choose a regression function to be the expectation of the conditional probability density function of the segmentation image given the template image. Right, this is optimal for the a mean squared error risk function. Now that we have chosen a regression function, we choose a regression estimator, r hat, that takes in this Atlas database of size m and our target image, say f. Now we want to, right, we want to measure the performance of our algorithm under varying databases and database sizes. So we treat am also as a random variable. Our error, like as motivated through our choice of the regression function itself, is standard mean squared error. Right, so the expectation over all templates and segmentations, the target templates, target segmentations, and databases. We decompose the error, which is computed over the entire image, into over individual pixels. This is just sum of squared errors over individual pixels. And right, so EV, so E of M is the global error. It's decomposed over EV of M for pixel V. And that error at pixel V is basically can be written as a sum of three terms, one of which is the variance of the conditional PDF, right? This is the intrinsic variability in the data. And the other two terms are the standard squared bias of the estimator and the variance of the estimator, right? So even though our estimator converged to the regression function that we wanted it to approximate, we would still have some error limited by the variance of the conditional PDF. Okay. So now we go on and say that we want to choose a particular kind of a regression estimator for the conditional expectation, and we choose the generalized k-nearest neighbor regression function. So basically, what this does is follows. So ignore phi of v for now. This is quite standard. So basically, we are going to look at, given k, which is the k nearest neighbors that we want to choose, rk is the distance to the kth nearest neighbor, w is a weighting function. So if a neighbor is within this set, the weighting function is 1. If the neighbor is outside the set of the k nearest neighbors, the weighting function is 0. And the regression estimator is nothing but the weighted average of the segmentations of the k nearest neighbors. Okay, that's the simplest thing that we could use. Okay? Sorry? Right. You can measure distances between two images in several ways. So you yeah right right yeah so exa- right Yeah, so in general, the framework allows us to apply apply some linear or nonlinear lifting map to our image features. You go into some kernel feature space and you do regression there. So we are using as the Mercer kernel the normalized cross correlations on patches around the pixel of interest. Okay, so we are basically using normalized cross correlation as our similarity metric.
So just to clarify, by distance, you actually mean similarity, right? So decreasing.
No, by distance I don't mean similarity. Distance would be inverse of similarity.
So in
this case, k nearest neighbors would be k most similar neighbors. Maximum similarity would translate to minimum distances. Yeah.
Are you using an actual distance value or are you using a similarity value? They are
equivalent.
But I mean an inverse
way. Yeah, correct.
So in your formula that actually makes a difference, right?
These are distances. So the formula is correct. The formula implies distances. To compute these distances, we can use a kernel. Okay, given a kernel similarity, okay, given a kernel, we have implicitly the lifting map phi defined, and what I'm saying is just we take distances in the space phi of f. Okay. Yeah. So the way we compute it is, of course, using we can compute this using the kernel values themselves. Depends on the kernel. So right now we choose a very similar kernel. So we're just looking at we don't have a lifting map that's going to lift us to some infinite dimensional space or anything. But you could do that. Somebody could do that and come up with a better scheme. Correct. Yeah. If FK was the kth distant neighbor. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Huh. It's similar. They will have similar effects. Yeah. I'm going to show one way of tuning that k for a given problem. Given problem means given anatomical structure, given imaging modality, given registration method, segmentation method, and so on. Okay. Okay. Now, given this regression estimator, somebody else, thankfully, has worked out the bias and the variance as a function of several parameters, including the database size and the k in the k nearest neighbors that you seek. Okay, so of course, the estimator bias also depends on the shape of the probability distribution of the images, feature map that we are using, the dimensionality, and so on and so forth. Okay, So it turns out that the bias is approximated using via this form, and the variance is approximated using that form. The main variables of interest, the main expressions of interest here is that, say, yeah, the variance of the estimator dies down as a function of 1 over k, depending on the variance of the conditional PDF of the segmentation given the template. And the bias goes by bias has this multiplier factor of k divided by m to the power 2 divided by d. So D is the dimensionality of the image patches in theory. M is the size of the database, and K is the k nearest neighbors that we chose. Now, we choose a particular weighting function such that psi, this term psi, just amounts to the constant 1. So now, the expected error at each voxel is representable in this parametric form. So we have alpha v, which is basically the expectation of the conditional PDFs over all f's, times 1 plus 1 over k plus some other constant beta v multiplied by k by m to the power of this guy. Okay. So now, this makes sense because, for instance, as the size of the database m goes to infinity, we can make the number k also go to infinity, but at a slower rate, such that the last term goes to 0, and the first term, so this number, so and 1 over k goes to 0, so all we are left with is alpha v, which is basically the intrinsic variability of the segmentations given the images. Okay, we just cannot do any better than that. Now, this was our model at a per pixel level. We sum this up over all pixels, and now we have a model for how good the segmentation is over the entire image. Okay, so now the basic idea is we have a model for expected segmentation error. Now, given a training database, so to speak, we can compute these expected errors empirically, and we use bootstrap sampling of the targets and the segmentations and the databases, and for each database size m, we'll get a curve of these error functions, and we fit this parametric model to that curve. All right. We do that at every pixel v. The fitting problem is a standard nonlinear curve fitting problem. Now we would expect our parameters to vary smoothly over space, and we use a spatial smoothness prior on the estimated parameters. So this is just in the parameter optimization part, the curve fitting part. We are essentially fitting all curves together because we can get stuck in local minima. And then for any database size m, this parametric form gives us the error as a function of k. All right. So we can choose k to minimize the error for any given database size m. Yes. Good point. Yes, so we could have computed a k for every pixel in the image separately. All right, we could have, because we have a regressor at every pixel in the image. But in this work, we just didn't do that. Maybe we thought practically it makes a little more sense to choose a k for the entire image. Yes. This is a good point. What did I do about that? Okay, is there a restriction? There is no restriction on picking the same k images for every pixel.
But then you're not the same algorithm, right?
No, it's the same.
Because when you're actually running this algorithm, you are going to pick the same k images.
No, we are not.
Wait, then maybe I misunderstood the algorithm.
Yeah, so okay, so the initial broad framework that I mentioned was just a, you know, an umbrella framework. Within that, several, you know, there are several engineering issues there. Right, so in this case, yeah, so we are not picking the same k, we're not picking the same neighbors for every pixel.
I see. So but every pixel independently you pick some k nearest.
Some k, but the value of k is the same. Right, and yeah, and I'm saying we could have even chosen a separate value of k for every pixel. But we thought it was an overkill.
Yeah, that
does seem
better.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. All right, so results. We took a large database where we have manually segmented images. Instead of looking at the error, we thought it would be more practical to look at relative error, you know, scaled down by the size of the object. Yeah, and this had some, you know, useful semantics to other error, other performance evaluation metrics that are more popular in the literature. Yeah, now. Apart from sampling the target images and the smaller databases of size m, we also do bootstrap sampling on the available database itself to know the variability of our, you know, curve fitting and prediction under variations in the available database itself. Okay, so here are the curves that we get. Okay, so first we are just interested in, you know, whether the model fits well to the data. Okay, so we just choose fix k to 8, and for that k, we evaluate the mean square errors for various database size values, and these are our box plots, and so the box plots come because of sampling on the larger available database. For every curve, we do a parametric fit, and we have one such fit for every sampled available database of size 186. And we see that the fitted curves match the mean squared errors reasonably well. Okay. All right. Okay, so as we can imagine, right, our parameter fitting happens at a per pixel basis. Remember, alpha v was the lowest error that we could get at any pixel v. Now, of course, we would assume. Okay, so here the object of interest is the so-called thalamus, which basically has a boundary there. So we can see that the left and the bottom left part of the boundary is relatively easier to determine than the right part of the boundary. Of course, segmentation in general is also an easier task for pixels well inside the object and pixels that are well outside the object. It's an easy regression problem, so the errors are really low. And most of the high errors are in those parts of the boundary where the contrast is low or the registration didn't work well and so on and so forth. So this is intuitive. Beta, the parameter beta represents the complexity of the regression function and the probability distribution of the images and so on. So again, the complexity of the multi-atlas segmentation task is much larger for that part of the boundary, which is not easy to see. And D is the dimension. Okay, so now, the formulation, right, the theory would say that the parameter D is the dimension of the image patches that we take. But in theory, so in practice, what happens is that D actually, so we fit D to the mean squared error terms as well, and D actually comes out close to the intrinsic dimension of the data that we have. Right? So k nearest neighbor regressors, and there is related work that talks about similar results on kernel-based regression as well, that talk about the convergence rates going down not as a function of the dimensionality of representation of the data, but as a function of the intrinsic dimension of the data. Okay, so this is what we see as well, and we find this intrinsic dimension somewhere, you know, around 4, 6, 8, and so forth, so on. Okay, so now we go to our prediction task that we need to solve. So here what we do is, yeah, so we treat these same baseline curves as we had, the same curves that we had in the last slide as our baseline curves. Now we take, we sample databases of size 40 from this large database. Now only using the a database of size 40, we do these box plots, right? They go only all the way to 40. We fit our parametric model to the box plots, well, to the errors available only till database size 40, and then extrapolate our model and see how close it comes to the fitted curves that we fitted using the entire database. Okay, yeah, so here what you want to say is that the predictions come close, the predictions using a 40 size database come close to what we actually observe using the entire 180 size database. Right, now on top of that, we can optimize K, like for this class of multi-atlas segmentation problem, for any particular size M, and consistent with what the theory predicts, K does increase as the size of the atlas database increases, and this is the curve. So we somehow, magically, maybe luckily, we had picked our initial K to be 8 in the first set of experiments, and that turns out to be not completely off, so things didn't work that bad. All right, and now then we can do the same prediction using optimal values of K. Now it actually, yeah, it turns out since the variation in K in our database isn't too much, it goes probably from 4 to 14. So changing the fixed K around 8 does not give us too much improvement in the errors here. Okay, fact of life, maybe in some other data set it did. And now we compare these results to something that was done a few years ago by somebody else, where they had a much simplistic model, more intuitively derived, which basically predicted another similarity measure as a function of, as this particular function, a minus b by square root m, where m is the atlas database size. And yeah, so we ran their predictions using the same database that we had, and we saw that their errors were, right, so their predictions were more off than their model fits using the entire database. So that's all I have. Yes. Yeah. Different image. Yeah, so okay, so we are registering, right, we are aligning each image in the database, each template in the database to the target. So this alignment process makes sure that all images are roughly in the same coordinate frame, are in the same coordinate frame. So they are aligned rotationally and translationally and scale. In fact, they are non-linearly aligned, so it's a little more than that as well. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Yes. Yes, there are. Yeah, it's just that such a database wasn't available to us, so we did this. Yeah, but the theory is general enough to handle such cases as well. Yeah, so if you have multiple, right, so if you ask, instead of one expert, if you ask 10 experts to segment the same image, you will get 10 different answers, and you could, there are methods to convert. So in this framework, we keep those 10 different answers exactly as they are. You could have converted those 10 different answers into a fuzzy segmentation image and then use that instead. Okay, so yeah, but yeah, usually exponents don't do fuzzy segmentation. It's yeah, assigning a label to an object or not, that itself is a laborious task. Now, if you tell them on top of that that no, you have to give a probability, they're not going to do it. Yeah, anything else? Yeah. Anything. Yeah, you could apply to anything. Yeah. The math is general enough. Oh, I'm not looking into that, but if you are looking into that, then let me know. All right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so we assume that is, yes, so typically registration methods may do some pre-processing. And yeah, so we don't do anything extra than what the registration methods are doing. Different sizes. The alignment takes care of the size issue. We are doing a nonlinear warp, right? We are. So yeah. So if one guy has a larger spleen than the other guy, if I map the larger spleen to my spleen, the mapping is going to do the appropriate shrinking. So yeah, this relates to her question as well. So. There are no issues of scale effects that are not accounted for, or rotations that are not accounted for, or anything like that. All that is taken care of. You're always in the same coordinate frame.